картина советских и общественных организаций перед рейтингом.
I just got back through spending 3 months in the Soviet Union, and one of the things that I do there a lot when I'm not working is I do something I do here a lot when I'm not working, I read the sports pages. So I wanted to talk with you today about my favorite Russian newspaper, my favorite Soviet newspaper, Sovietski Sport. But before we do it, probably have to say a few things about Soviet journalism in general, and obviously in particular the newspapers that you are most familiar with, Pravda and Izvestia. Now there's this old Soviet joke that every Soviet citizen knows, and you've probably heard it yourself a couple of times, but Pravda in Russian means truth, and Izvestia in Russian means the news. So the Russian joke goes is that there's no Pravda in Izvestia, there's no truth in the news, and there's no Izvestia in Pravda. Well, the only problem is that there's something to that joke, and we really have to talk a bit about a lot of these cliches that people have about the Soviet press. I mean, it is true that Pravda is controlled by the government, it is censored, they make no pretense to objectivity, and I emphasize pretense, and it can get a little boring with the same stories about fulfilling this plan and that plan all the time. But the fact is that you can read Pravda and Izvestia and get good information out of it. A large chunk, especially on international affairs, is really pretty straightforward. The other thing that people do, of course, over the years is that they learn to read between the lines, which is something that we know how to do here pretty well. Obviously, you don't read the New York Times and take everything that you get from it straight. Now, aside from Pravda and Izvestia, there are thousands of newspapers that are published in the Soviet Union. There are local newspapers, there's evening newspapers, which really kind of are like real tabloids. I mean, not like the New York Post, but they're kind of a little more racy. And the other thing that there are lots of are specialized newspapers for the various fields of life in the Soviet Union. So there's Komsomolskaya Pravda, which is the youth paper, which is kind of like a cross between, well, Tiger Beat meets Turbines. So that's an attempt to get youth and rock and roll and productivity and all the rest of that together. There's a thing called Socialist Industry. There's a newspaper called Literaturnaya Gazeta that's put out by the Union of Writers. And what's important is that if you are in any of these professional fields, what you've got to do is read these on a daily or weekly basis. Some of them come out 3 or 4 times a week so that you can keep up. So that people have to be apprised of information, apprised of changes in policy, and learn what's going on in their field. So they read this in a kind of professional way. And what that means is that everything that gets printed in the Soviet Union isn't necessarily a lie or propaganda, because the society couldn't possibly function without some correct and useful information being transmitted, especially in these areas where people need that information on a daily basis to do their work. And the fact is that in Soviet journalism, writers and reporters do real what you would call journalism, that they investigate stories, they write them, they sometimes even expose scandals. They don't just sit around and wait to get the word from Moscow and whatever the orders might be. Now, obviously, it would be naive to think that there's no central control in the Soviet Union, but reporters in the West also know that everything that they hear and see is not going to make it into the daily newspaper either. Nevertheless, what Soviet reporters do pretty much is work with a kind of preemptive censorship, knowing what they can and can't get away with, and always trying to push those boundaries a little bit. Now, there is an exception to that kind of general rule that you get about Pravda and Izvestia, in general a kind of fairly exceptional newspaper in the Soviet Union, my favorite newspaper, and that is Sovietski Sport. In fact, the whole area of sports in general is kind of an exceptional area. Now, Pravda and Izvestia don't cover sports really. There's maybe 3 or 4 inches, column inches a day, with just a few results of what the big teams did, or somebody won a chess championship or something like that. So instead of having sports in the main paper, they have a national sports daily, which is published 6 times a week by the Committee of Physical Culture and Sport of the Committee of Ministers of the Soviet Union. It's called Sovietski Sport. And it is probably the most popular newspaper in the Soviet Union. It sells out immediately. You can buy it at kiosks and newsstands. It sells out immediately, no matter where it's sold. And if you want to get it, you have to develop a close personal relationship with your local news dealer, give them presents, kind of talk about the weather with them. And the other sort of proof of how popular it is that some of you may have seen when television coverage of the of Moscow, and you see these bulletin boards with all the newspapers up on the wall, Pravda, Izvestia, Socialist Industry, something like that. There's one or two people around each, and then there's this big crowd, almost always all men, around Sovietski Sport. Everybody's elbowing each other out, trying to get to see the latest results. And there's a lot of public interest in sports in the Soviet Union, but not so much as you'd be led to think in things like wrestling or bicycling. People are not flocking to the stadiums to see archery or, you know, who knows what. The real interest in the Soviet Union is in the two main spectator sports, and that's hockey and soccer. And importantly, those are spectator sports that are entirely in the Soviet Union, as opposed to here, behind me, practiced by men, played by men, and enjoyed by men. If you go to a hockey arena or a stadium in the Soviet Union, you'll see 90%, maybe in soccer it's even 95% men. However, Sovietski sport gives every bit as much attention to women's sports as men's sports, just the way Soviet TV does. But really, hockey and soccer are the big-time sports, and in fact, they even have their own weekly newspaper devoted to it, and it's called, of all things, Football Hockey, which means soccer and hockey, obviously. And if you talk to any sort of Russian working Joe, whatever, Ivan, whatever you call him, they really are primarily interested in soccer and hockey, and maybe basketball, a real distant third, sometimes even volleyball, maybe a little bit boxing. And why do they want to know? They want to know who won, who got the goals, how come the local team is so crummy? And they find this out by reading Sovietski Sport. So sports writers in the Soviet Union practice what we in the West would call real journalism, which means that they go to events, they take notes, they write down what happened, and then it gets printed. So it really is very much like the Western practice that we associate with Western sports writers. One big difference is that although Soviet reporters have access to the locker rooms after games just the way Western reporters do, they don't usually, right after the story, right after the game, quote athletes and get their sweaty reflections on what happened. They usually wait till a week or so later, and maybe they'll doing a little kind of analytical piece on why the Central Army team, hockey team, is going through a slump. They rarely do, but and then would get quotes from the coach or the players as to what's happening. So for the most part, Soviet sports journalism is pretty much like ours. Now, Pravda and Izvestia may be different, but the New York Times and the Washington Post, that is, may be different from Pravda and Izvestia, but reading Sovietski Sport is pretty much like reading your local sports section, except for the fact that there's not much attention paid to local teams, unless, of course, you live in Moscow. Now, for the most part, and you'll see there's exceptions to this in a second, it's not that ideological, it's not that political, and what you get are, in fact, sports. Now, aside from the general coverage of what happened, when, and why, you do get in Sovietski Sport things like, on the front page, a description of an anti-war rally with 800,000 people in Moscow. You might get now Chernenko's latest statement on relations with the United States, which would be on the front page, or we'll see in a second, coverage of the May Day parade, something like that. And obviously you wouldn't see Reagan's latest statement on who knows what on the front page of Sports Illustrated or the Sporting News, which is not to say that there's not a lot of ideology in our sports coverage. Obviously there's a great deal, especially about making a virtue out of competition. The other thing that you see a lot of, aside from coverage of sports events, both international and national, in Sovietski Sport, is physical culture, sort of fitness coverage. And this is really read by specialists, by gym teachers, by people whose job it is to organize physical culture in factories. And it's designed to teach kids how to be sort of fit and better athletes, and also workers so they can be more productive workers. And usually the second page, and I'll show you that in a little bit, gives attention to that. And that's sort of ignored by the general public. But if you're concerned, like you're working at an institute of physical culture, or you're a teacher, then you get to pay attention to page two. But for the most part, people ignore page one and page two and get on to page three and four. It's four pages every day of hot news, both national and international. And this is what makes the paper so popular. Now, people in the Soviet Union love sports, not as much as Americans love sports. They get the story pretty straight in Sovietski sport. And this is why a lot of people like Sovietski sport. And they want to go do it. Well, I want to show you what Sovietski sport looks like, but before I tell you what's in it, I probably should say some of the things that are not in it. For instance, there are not too many stories about individual stars, and that you'd probably expect. There are not a whole lot of stories about drug scandals, and there are not too many stories about monster contracts that players sign, although obviously there are lots of interesting stories about monster contracts that people sign in the West. What we want to do is take a look at 1 week in the life of Sovietski sport. And the week we chose was totally at random. We just called up somebody in Los Angeles and said, please send us down a bunch of Sovietski sports. And they sent us down May of 1983. So we thought it would be nice to look at the first week of May, which begins, of course, with May Day. This is the May Day edition of Sovietski sport. And it looks pretty much like you'd expect a Soviet newspaper to look, with all of the proper heroism and Lenin, Engels, and Marx. They always include Engels in the middle. And a story about the triumphs of spring and what a great time of year it is and all the sort of cliches you expect. And on the top it says, happy 1st of May, dear friends. And then in the box here, it says, all hail May Day, this holidarity, the holiday of international solidarity of workers in the struggle against imperialism for peace, democracy, and socialism. And then if you look real close, you can see at the top of the, whatever you call it, the title here, this is probably the only sports paper in the world that says Workers of the World Unite on the front. It also shows you that it's published, been published since the 20th of June, 1924, 6 times a week, though probably they took a couple of days off for the war. Now here you've got at the top, above the fold, the big flashy story with all the politics and all the heroism you expect. But if you look below the fold, there's a couple of stories that are kind of interesting. The first one, in fact, there are actually 3 stories about soccer matches that took place the day before. And the first one begins with a description of the match and a real sharp criticism of the referee, who messed up. He gave, awarded a penalty kick when he shouldn't have, then he, there was a terrible foul, and he didn't. And the reporter is making this the lead of the story, and he's very overtly and clearly criticizing the referee. So the referee is no symbol of authority, and when there's something where the game doesn't really go well or smoothly, the reporters are very quick to criticize it. Another thing that's sort of interesting, during May of 83, and we'll see a bit more about it in a second, the World Hockey Championships were going on. And this is a story about the match between Canada, who's obviously the Soviet Union's big foe, and Sweden. And you can see that the score was 3-1. And again, this is a pretty straightforward description. I'll just read you one paragraph, which just tells you pretty much what happened in the match between Canada and Sweden. In the second minute, the Canadians were able to make a kind of European-style combination. They slid a diagonal pass from the defensive zone to the middle zone, where Bob Haney and Charlie Simmer got open. And Haney passed the puck to Simmer, who went in one-on-one on the Swedish goalie and opened the score. There it is, you know, no big deal, nothing particularly strange. Now, if we look the next day, May 2nd, well, first of all, on the front of it, we have coverage from Red Square of the May Day Parade, complete with who participated, and again, lots of crowd shots, and a few shots of heroic youth looking athletic. Then if we look on the back page, on the top it says, you know, using the Olympic motto, what is it, faster, higher, and stronger. Here's a kind of series of reflections and quotes from the coach of the team and the Soviet national hockey team and a couple of players about their 1-1 tie with Czechoslovakia. And then here's a story about the Canadian national team, who they're going to play next. And it's very interesting because it says the Canadian players are coming here very tired. They've played this arduous schedule in the NHL. They're really not going to be able to give their best effort. And also, the best Canadian players won't be playing because the Stanley Cup playoffs are winding down. They're in their, whatever, penultimate phase. And so people like Wayne Gretzky, who everybody knows and loves in the Soviet Union, is not going to be playing against the Soviet Union in the World Championship of 83. So they're very clear in explaining to the fans, who all know it anyway, that the Canadian team is not really the best virtuous, not best, but the best possible team that the Canadians can put on the ice. So that they understand that when they win, which they will do 2 days later, it's no big deal. Well, it's a big deal, but not as big a deal. There's also on page two, I mentioned these stories of physical culture and youth training. And here's a series of exercises for soccer coaches to give to their young students who are learning soccer for the first time, and a lot of drills and things like that. Then here's a soccer roundup of all the games and kind of who's doing what and well. And here's the standings and the leading scorers. And here's an interesting thing of the all-time leading scorers in the history of Soviet soccer. And if they want to get really heroic, we can go to just 2 days later on May 4th when they win the World's Hockey Championships. And here you are with the team. Here's their captain, Vyacheslav Fetistov, the famous goalie, Tretiak. Viktor Krutov, one of their best wings, left wing in fact, and the national team. Here are the various steps they made along the way, a description of the match, and then perhaps this is a little heroic, but it's about as heroic as they get, and it says, again we hear the Sovietski, well, the Soviet national anthem. The Soviet hockey team wins for the 19th time. And then they get a little, well, I wouldn't say poetic, but they say, May is a special month in our calendar, a month of peace, labor, and of course spring. Workers like to meet the holiday with presents, and many laboring collectives report about their achievements on the 1st of May, or give them an honor of the 1st of May. A wonderful present to the lovers of sport was given by our Soviet hockey team. Our heroic storied ice militia has won the championship of Europe and the world in the Federal Republic of Germany, West Germany. And again we hear the Soviet national anthem. Again we see the flag of the country of Soviets. Then they kind of cool it. Well, they have one brief paragraph here where they talk about that this 19th time that they've won the championship ties the number of times the Canadians have won. But the Canadians have been playing since, about 1920, and the Russians have been participating in the World Championships only since 1954. And of course, remember in the other story, we know that the Canadians don't send their best team to that championship, as they even show you in Sovietski Sport. Then they kind of cool it and get into what happened, who scored the goals, and why the team won. Now, there's some interesting things on the back. One thing you probably noticed, as I've shown you, Sovietski Sport, is they're not any ads. Well, there's an occasional ad, and here on the back is an ad for a brand new Soviet TV, a tabletop color model, 25 centimeters diagonal, costing 470 rubles, which is about 2 months' salary for an average worker. Color again, and you can take it with you wherever you want. Now, right above it is an ad for the, not really an ad, but for the sport lottery. Every week there is a lottery in which the winner can win 10,000 rubles, and here it is, the name of the winning ticket, the numbers of the winning tickets for that particular week. So they do have lotteries in the Soviet Union, just like here, and people can win actual prizes. Sometimes they can win less than 10,000. You can win 5 rubles or 55 rubles and 100 rubles. Once a week, they give away 10,000 rubles, which is a lot of money. You can buy a car, you can maybe buy an apartment with 10,000 rubles. Now, on May 5th, we get a little more politics on the front page again. Here is an announcement of the Soviet Bicyclists for Peace. They're going on a special biking tour of the Soviet Union, and in honor of that, they have all signed a petition supporting the following demands, which all peace-loving people in the world subscribe to. Yes to the destruction of atomic weapons, no to atomic arms, no to the first strike, and yes to disarmament and peace. Now, on the next day, we see the Bicyclists for Peace on their merry way. And then on the bottom of the article, there is a declaration of support and solidarity for their task of peace from the Soviet equestrian team. Yes, the Soviets do participate in horse shows and all the rest of that stuff. Very proletarian sport, no doubt. Now, Soviet sport, or Sovietski sport, actually everybody just, because everything in the Soviet Union is Sovietski, right? They just call it sport. So when you go to the newsstand and you say, I want to buy Sovietski, you don't say that, you say, I want to buy sport. Or they ask you, did you read sport? And sport costs 3 kopecks a day, which is the official equivalent of 5 cents, maybe in terms of the way it figures out to a person's monthly income, maybe a little more than that. But basically, it's real cheap and easy to get if you can find it. And that's the general problem of life in the Soviet Union. Things are not that expensive, they're just hard to find. Well, I thought it might be interesting to see, because there is a lot of sports on Soviet TV, just what they would show in an average week, during a week, on Soviet TV. And they, every week, put the listings, just like you do in the TV guide or in whatever, the local newspaper, of what's going to be on TV that week. So it might be fun to see what they've got, because after all, among other things, you know that they consider chess to be a sport. And every morning at 8 o'clock, they have morning gymnastics, which are not aerobics. They're going to be showing on the 9th of May the European Gymnastics Championships, a scientific technical film about healthy fellows. That's what it says here. Then a special report on the bike trip for peace. On the 10th of May, chess school. A report on sport for the week. A report on soccer for the week. And again, on the next day, another report on the bike trip for peace. On the 11th of May, a wonderful show called The Stadium for Everybody, which is about participant sports, and they do features on jogging clubs and Omsk and things like that. More from the chess school, more from the European gymnastic championships, and also from the boxing championships. A repeat of sport for the week, and another report from the bike trip for peace. On the 12th of May, a report, not another report, but another lesson from the chess school. A report on the International Meeting of Motorsports. I have no idea what they showed on that. And what they call an artistic film called Green Games. Who knows what that's about? More from the European Championship of Boxing on the 13th of May, and a soccer game, just the second half of it. More from the bicycle race for peace. And then another second half of another soccer game between the Bakut oil guys and Spartak of Moscow. Then on the 14th, the drawing for the lottery, pretty exciting. Another nice show called So You Want to Be Healthy, which is about physical fitness. More chess school, more championship of Europe in boxing, a soccer game between the Central Army team and a team from Lithuania, and a documentary film called Ballet on Ice. So that's what they get for an average week on Soviet TV. Well, in conclusion, there's really one thing I want to say about my favorite Soviet newspaper, Sovietski Sport, is that I spend a lot of time reading it, and really it feels pretty much like reading the sports section of your local newspaper, if it's the San Diego Union or the New York Post. It's really not that much different, and it's a lot of fun and gives a lot of people pleasure.
Самой лучшей девушке своей. Если писем не получишь, сообщи скорей. Если есть в письме ошибки, дело не хитро. Здесь чернила очень липки, очень скверное перо. It's a long way to Tipperary. It's a long way to go. It's a long way to Tipperary.